Hey there, comic friends, I'm Travis.
And I'm the Disembodied Voice.
And this is
Monster Comic Review.
That's right, and these are our comics for February 1st, 2017. A little over a week old, but we're going to talk about it anyway. We're going to test our memory. First up, we're going to talk Batman, issue number 16.
I am Bane, part one.
Or is it, I'm Bane, part one?
Yeah, it depends on whether or not you're going with the film. I liked the Batman burger place. I thought that was kind of funny. I mostly loved Bruce's reaction to the Batman burger place.
Right, so...
And all of the stuff between the three Robins, especially Damian. You know, Damian's hijinks. And the fact that he did not order the Happy Meal.
Yes. So they're at a burger joint. That's... where they're having their meeting at, as opposed to meeting in the Batcave. The boys think that would be a funner thing, so it's the boys and Bruce. And Thomas? Is his name Thomas? Why am I drawing that guy's name?
Duke. Yeah.
Thomas. Duke, anyway. So they're all together. That's his burger joint. The burger joint is basically franchised Batman, so there's the Bat Burgers. Poison ivy salad and whatnot.
Not poisonous.
Yes, and you can jokerize your fries. The guy asks Bruce if he wants his fries jokerized, and of course Bruce kind of goes off on him the fact that, you know, the Joker's a homicidal maniac that wants to dance on all of their graves.
So that's a no to the jokerizing,
right? So there's some funny, there's some levity in there. The three boys, whatever, they're all. Three of them are adults, or two of them are adults.
Right.
Anyway,
the three Robins.
They're all joking amongst themselves and whatnot. You know, it's that part of it is fun writing. There's a serious, it gets serious at a moment too, because they're all commenting on the fact they've all died, with the exception of Duke. They have all been dead, and
right.
Duke's like, wait a second, that's not a requirement for being part of this whole thing, is it? And Bruce doesn't find it funny because, of course,
Red Robin is still dead.
Is still dead, supposedly.
Yeah, we know the truth.
Right, but they don't.
Exactly.
So that was kind of an interesting moment. I kind of like that. I did like the whole banter between them. I thought that was all, you know, kind of fun stuff and whatnot. And basically it's Bruce once again, like he does anytime any villain shows up or anything supposedly scary is going to happen. He tells everybody to go away. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, that's typical. And they all say, forget that.
So why do it? Why do it? I don't know.
I don't have an answer for you. I was giving you my face.
Right. You're right. I mean,
dads are dumb sometimes.
Yeah.
Guardians are. You want to keep your people safe, even if they aren't going to.
Right. Okay. So instead, you shoot them off, and then they wander off on their own to do the stupid stuff and get themselves hurt.
Yeah, it makes more sense to bring them under your wing.
At any rate, so there's that part of it, and then we get the whole. He basically explaining that Bane is coming to get him. Bane's coming. They have to keep Psycho Pirate for 5 days because they need to do 5 days worth of therapy on Gotham Girl,
Gwen,
to get her fixed from the shattered state that she is in. And of course, anybody, if you've been reading this, if you remember back in the end of the I Am Suicide, Bruce basically gets in Bane's face at the very end of it and basically kind of mocks him and dares him to show up and take on Bruce. So I don't know if Batman's got a plan, that's all part of the plan, or he was just having a stupid day kind of a thing, because now he's going to have to deal with Bane showing up and wrecking the town or whatever. I both like and dislike this continued Batman portrayal in it. It's okay. I mean, I still feel like that Batman's a fairly shallow character.
Yeah, I feel like it's better than it was, but it's still not great.
But what made it better was all those other people.
True. True.
Yeah?
I don't have anything else to say. Yeah, the little interaction that's pictured on the cover, so to speak, was okay. And the ending was a little startling.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Next. Right, right. We get a cliffhanger at the end of it. Oh, dun, dun, dun.
Right.
The Fall and Rise of Captain Atom, issue number 2 of 6. Did you read this?
I actually did.
Okay.
The first one was so much...
Full disclosure, it's taken a while for the Disembodied Voice to get caught up on comics. So for a while, she was probably reading, I don't know, 20 comics a day to get caught up.
It took a while.
And so the reason I ask is because there was stuff that was just kind of skipped because...
Exactly. And that one, I think I read the first, like, half of issue one because it was just so much exposition. I'm like,
did they ever get done talking about how he was made?
No. And you told me that, you know, in the end he got pushed back into the past. And this issue is kind of interesting. The whole life that he had, I didn't hate it. I thought it was interesting. And then he gets pushed into the future again.
Right, so he gets thrown back into the past in like 1994 or something like that, I think it is. And of course, he doesn't exist. He never had the accident. He never became Captain Atom. He actually predates superheroes.
Right.
He does some heroics because it's just kind of who he is or what he's gotten used to. Not enough to get himself really noted or anything. He's writing a book. He's kind of doing all this kind of, you know, sneaky living on the side. And, you know, he questions whether or not he should get married because he's waiting for there to be some cosmic backlash if you manipulate time and do something different. You go back in the past and manipulate it, what happens? You know, there's all these wonderful theories out there as to exactly what happens, so he's kind of concerned about that.
He consults a kind of
quantum physics person.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, not that he necessarily knows either, clearly. But, you know, he goes on with his life, and he's slowly slipping back into being Cat Venom. He gets these flashes of metallic skin and whatnot, and then it goes full on at one point. But he's still back in 2007, I want to say. By the time he gets to the point where he goes full
sure,
on,
yeah.
where he becomes full on Captain Atom again, at least in look, the whole metallic look to him, and that's still pre-super.
It's still pre-superheroes, and it comes at a very inopportune time in his marriage too.
Yes, because his wife is pregnant,
and she hasn't. They're just getting ready to get together, and she's going to tell him.
Right.
And,
but he's been attacked by some goons out on the highway, and. It's actually a very opportune time for him to turn into that because he's...
Sure, except for the part where...
He's in a car that's being shot up and crashed and all that kinds of stuff, so... So, anyway, yeah, it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
It's nothing that exciting. I mean, so far, not anything I'd tell anybody to go get, by any means. Faith, issue number 8! The ghosts!
Yes, I still like Faith, and it feels like Jody Hauser is dialed back... there's still a million references.
100%.
She's dialed back. 100%. There's not like 4 per sentence now, so
yeah.
That's nice.
Yeah.
I appreciate them because I get, you know,
the whole geek reference
them,
stuff is fun.
Which is fun.
Mm-hmm.
And in this one, yes, it's the conclusion of her Faith seeing ghosts that are basically telling her that she sucks.
Mm-hmm.
For letting them die.
I did find that was pretty funny, though. So she's in a situation where she hates horror films. I mean, she really hates all scary stuff.
That part
she does not like it whatsoever.
Love.
So she calls up somebody she works with that she's not really friends with, but knows at work who is a horror film fan, loves horror films, invites her over to see the ghosts that are haunting her, these half-skeletal-looking ghosts and whatnot, thinking she'll be fine. If she actually sees them, because, of course, she sees horror stuff all the time. And, of course, she shows up and completely loses her shit because there's a big difference between, you know, watching a silly horror movie and there being the real thing.
Right.
So that's all really funny.
Yeah,
and, of course, there's a kind of a pep talk in there about the fact that, look, you know, I'm the cynical, look at the world as being, you know, blacky and awful. That's just who I am. But, you know, your faith, your supposed to be this embodiment of hope and seeing the good in people, blah, 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 blah. Pep talk gets over with. Yes, we can do it. Goes in, finds out that it's not really ghosts. It's all technically designed by her ex-boyfriend's ex-girlfriend.
Right, the alien.
Yeah.
Who's also an alien.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That has so much bearing on anything because
life
because it's not like her alien powers like give her any
and
you know.
Apparently she can't just go on Twitter and talk about how horrible she is, so she had to do this instead.
Yeah. So at any rate, and at the end of it, she looks like she's hooking up with another nemesis of Faith's.
Yeah, so that should be interesting. The one that wants to be her arch nemesis.
Right.
the actor.
Right. For me, this book isn't real depthy. It's fun. You know, it has a, you know, almost every issue has a moment in it that you're kind of supposed to go, yeah, to, in one sense or another, kind of thing. The stories are short, mm-hmm. in that it's one or two issues, kind of gets done with the kind of immediate thing. Clear, like I said, we've talked about this. Her personal arch enemy is in this one. He's kind of shown up in a few issues ago. So there's a larger story, but it's these nice kind of simple,
yep.
done kind of things, which I enjoy, you know, for that sense also. So yeah, it's like I said,
a typical issue of Faith, but yeah. I really like Faith.
So it doesn't blow me away, but it's a fun character, and so I'm enjoying
that. I always
look
forward to reading.
So.
I like her.
No. Green Arrow, issue number 16. Which you didn't read.
I did not read it.
Because I told her I was dropping it. So, why read it? We're trying to catch up on comics, right? So, I read it, and it just continues to confirm my, I think I'm done. I'm done reading it. Nothing in here inspires me to want to continue to get it. There's this whole kind of, they squelch most of the Emerald Outlaw aspect of this, and everybody kind of comes back and vouches for him. He saves the detective again. Ollie's sister shows up,
Oh, good.
Back in it, she now insists on being called Red Arrow. That part I don't know how excited I am for that aspect of it, and. Of course, the larger issue we have is there's still this Black Archer that's out there doing damage to his reputation, and some excitement ensues at the end of it. I don't know. I'm just continue to not be entertained enough for two times a month kind of a comic. I like the art, but even the art is starting to feel, Juan Ferrara here, feels rushed. I mean, because I know they've got tighter deadlines and that sort of thing, so...
I love these characters. I do not love this comic.
Right. It's the story. It lacks inspiration. It's not fun. It doesn't have, Batman.
It lacks inspiration and it also lacks depth.
Batman, I pick on Batman and whatnot, but at least this last issue, there was this, good moment amongst the Bat family, which made the book
mm-hmm.
well enough for me not to go, Christ, about the whole thing. Faith, I talk about Faith not being necessarily incredibly depthy or complex, fun character doing fun things, short, sweet, kind of stories moving on. This just meanders and is uninspiring for me.
Yeah, the last issue I read was two issues ago, the mansplaining issue.
Oh, yeah. That's what I basically decided was done. Yeah. So, next up is Hawkeye issue number 3, The Hate for Kate. Escalates.
Actually, I really enjoy Kate, so I just think
love
this is
Kate
fun.
Bishop. Yeah.
I really like it. So what's on those stickers? You think drugs?
Oh yeah, so she's being chased by people wearing masks, and technically it's not the mask, there's like this little almost looks like it's either a sticker or a nicotine patch, that sort of looking thing that ends up on the people, and when it gets on them they've got some sort of mind control of sorts. I don't know what it is.
Anyway,
per se.
I'm pleased to have her back.
Like the cast of characters in this. Yes. So she's moved to L.A. This is issue 3. She's moved to L.A. She's going back to being the private eye kind of a thing. Superhero on the side kind of a deal. She's not official anything. She's kind of got some quasi-cop contacts who don't want to completely shut her down, but at the same time, stay out of my way kind of stuff. There's a tattoo artist that's like next door down the street. I'm not sure exactly what, but she is
Ramon, right?
Yeah.
I love her.
She's really cool. Of course, the reason they're connected to each other right now is because Kate took a job with her ex-girlfriend,
mm-hmm.
recently ex-girlfriend. Kind of a thing. There's a guy also that Kate kind of they kind of ogle each other and whatnot, and then when they start to have conversations with each other, the conversations get kind of that stupid.
Isn't that Ramon's brother?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It ends up being Ramon's brother.
Yes.
Kind of a thing. So there's kind of a fun cast of characters around her, and that all makes it fun. I think that Kelly Thompson writing this, she does a good job of kind of capturing a mix of what Fraction did with with her in the Hawkeye comic, and then with Karen Gillian and Jim McKelvey's work in Young Avengers, kind of taking the personalities that were developed in those two titles, and does a good job of, yes. You know, she's doing her own thing.
Yeah, she feels comfortable to
right.
me.
Right, like she's doing her own thing, but she clearly is Kate, mm-hmm. You know, and Kate is a hilarious character. I mean, I love her pep talks where she's always, you know, she, you know, talks to herself all the time. You know, so her pep talks to herself are always kind of funny as she's, you know, climbing through,
yes.
stuff and, you know, wandering through the horrible art, you know, the horrible art that's in this,
yes.
place that she's at and whatnot. You know, so yeah. the art by Romero is great. Joey Blair's colors, you know, nails it,
oh,
as always.
I love the color a lot.
So yeah, just a really, I'm really happy. It's another Marvel comic that I'm just, you know, really, really pleased with. Not on the same level of blowing my socks off as Spider-Woman continues to do, but still really enjoyable.
Spider-Woman fan.
Not a book I would contemplate dropping by any sense. Lots of fun. Issue 6 of Karnak. Issue 5 of Karnak probably came out, I want to say, well before Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's probably been 6 months plus. I mean, I think issue of Karnak number one came out more than a year ago, I want to say. So, we get this issue.
It's a kind of the closure.
Drop my comics. So yeah, end of the arc, and the book's not going on from here. End of the arc, and the book's not going on from here. So this was the end of the story. Issue 6. So, I like the story. I like the character. I like Warren Ellis's take on the character. I think he's really interesting. Would love to have read a lot more. Would have loved to have read a lot more of it consistently.
Yeah, that would have been helpful for
in
me
some
too,
sense.
Because this is my
no
first
payoff.
Exposure to this character.
No payoff. There's payoff in this. I mean, because the end of it, he gets rewarded. You know, his payment from the family that he's hunting down this inhuman for to bring their kid back. Is a family portrait of a happy time in their lives. And I'm sure that would have a whole lot more impact on me if I'd actually had just recently read the other issues.
Exactly.
You know, for this to all get meshed together and work out really well and whatnot. This is the last of the arc. This is just a cleanup issue. This is to ultimately deal with the problem and then have the camera come in and have a quiet moment with our main character, and then cutscene, we're done.
I thought the ending was really depressing.
Yeah? Like, it was supposed to be.
I know, it was. It was a very depressing moment.
But I think it would have been, I think it would have, for me, personally, it would have had more impact.
Oh, yes.
Having had this other issue. So, something I'll probably go back and read all together.
It's
merely 6 issues, you know, no big deal. Read them all together as one thing. I think it's good. I mean, like I said, I really enjoyed it, you know. But you seriously got hampered by the massive, massive delay.
I'm with you on that. I don't really have anything else to add.
Okay. I really should.
What he does to that kid was, wow.
Well, the kid's a god. I mean, he literally, the inhuman in this that he takes care of literally can suss out whatever your desire is and gives it to you. Plus, he just creates whatever role. So, Mike, if your desire is, you know, is flying monkeys that play the banjo, flying monkeys that play the banjo show up.
I understand.
Yeah. I mean, but I mean, that's
I
me being goofy.
The point of doing that.
But he literally is altering reality to meet whatever he thinks it needs to meet. So,
he and the girl from Fables could make a very interesting world.
Yeah, they're kind of the exact same character, aren't they? Midnight on Apollo, issue number 5 of 6, penultimate issue. This miniseries. Did you read this?
I did, but I don't remember it. Oh, that's right. Yes, I do. They're in hell.
Well, yeah, they've been in hell almost the entire time.
I know.
So it's him going face to face with
Neron, right?
Neron,
which is, he's been popular lately because
Neron's is a huge DC devil villain. I mean,
I didn't know that he was.
Yeah.
I just was thinking that as a demon in general, he was very popular. I didn't realize that he's supposed to be consistent throughout the DC universe.
Yeah. And so he gets
Midnighter. Anything like the Midnighter Neron that
Yeah, that's in that was in Hellblazer. Yeah.
But I'll stop.
But that was a different universe.
Okay.
That was the New 52 version of him. This is the rebirth version of him.
Okay. Yes.
Keep up in your continuity, man. Anyway, so yes, Midnighter. So he gets in a big. Basically, Midnighter gets in a big, you know, fisticuffs with him, and basically lets him beat the hell out of him. You know, up until the last moment. And then right now, I can't remember because this is one of the first comics I read last week.
I don't remember what Midnighter.
I can't remember how Midnighter at one point thinks he has him beat.
He does beat him. It's just then he finds out that.
Right, that.
That Apollo's not in
the. Apollo's not there.
Not in the bell jars, or whatever that is you want to say that he's in. He doesn't exist.
Yeah, I can't remember exactly what he.
And Neron tries to tell him that his soul has been eaten and destroyed, but of course we know that Apollo's flying around hell trying to find Midnighter.
Right. Oh, he uses that power. He has a power he's been banking, and he activates it for that brief moment.
Right.
He activates this deity. It basically rides along with him and helps him kick ass for a while, and then it falls down. And so we're left with one issue for Midnighter to come and find him. Not Midnighter, but Apollo to come and find him in hell and then to supposedly get out of it. There's been some fun action in this as a whole. I have not enjoyed this near as much as the Midnighter regular series that was going on for a while. There was to me, it just felt like it was much more intense. There was a lot more going on in that. And
well, the stuff with the gardener.
Well, right. Well, I think at the time that Orlando, who writes this and wrote that, I think he was just throwing everything out there. You know, I don't know how long I'm going to be working here for DC, so you know, this is my one shot. I'm going to put everything into it. Of course, it's earned him a lot of other work. You know, now he writes Supergirl. He's writing. He can write Justice League of America. You know, he's writing some of the crossover events and stuff. So clearly, everyone was impressed at DC with him to allow him to write as much stuff as he's been writing. But this just doesn't have the same intensity
when
does.
When the first issue came out, I thought, yay, I love Midnighter and Apollo. They're fabulous. And I was just kind of like.
Yeah. And then they immediately split them up, so they weren't even really a couple for more than a few pages.
Exactly.
And so it's not been about them together. It's just been.
Yeah.
Rather standard, go to hell and get your loved one back.
Exactly.
Because you know, we all do that. Because we all do that all the time. Right? Anything else you want to say about that?
Nope.
On to Nightwing, number 14.
The end of the first Bloodhaven arc.
Yep. What'd you think?
Actually, it was kind of an interesting ending. I liked the fact that, what's her name? The graffiti artist. I liked the fact that she, at the end, tells him, yes, I already knew, I've known this whole time that you were.
Right, right. What is his secret
idea?
Right, right.
But it was pretty interesting because I like that was Mr. Nice. That was not the person I expected I did not expect the villain to be that villain. So that was kind of nice for me.
Yeah.
That, or either not nice.
Right, right.
I don't know. I didn't hate it.
It's okay. I'm normally a big Marcus Tu fan who does the artwork for this. It was way lighter. And a lot of the art felt very ethereal, and it didn't have any weight on the page. Especially the stuff where they're out of costumes. It's very, very, to me, it was very pale, and I just didn't find that pleasant. Whereas the stuff that's been in that's been in Nightwing before this was. I suck today. I cannot remember the artist's name. Fernandez. I want to say it's Fernandez. It's probably not exactly right. It was the art before us. I really liked that. The Raptor arcs.
The
art of that.
That.
Oh, it's just really, really good. And so, you know, part of comic books is the art, so I just haven't been as excited. And, well, even this just seems very. It feels
soft
very.
And boyish and not.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that he has to have some sort of jaw. It's just it
no, but I'm just saying, just a lot of.
You can't look at that and say, yes, that's Dick Grayson.
Well, it's just a lot of. I don't know.
Except for Dick Grayson is in his costume.
Right. I don't know. It's just a lot of it didn't have. didn't have the...
And it's funny, because I really didn't notice that until you pointed it out.
See, just, to me, it just, I don't know, something about it, it just has kind of an odd weight to it. And like I said, normally I'm a big Marcus II fan, and it may be... I think he's doing it... I'm looking through the credits here just to see what's going on. Yeah, he's the artist, so it's not like somebody else is inking him. He's doing his own, inking or whatever, and then Chris Sotomayor is doing the colors on it. So, I don't know. I don't know what the deal is. I don't know if this is a newer style for him, or it's a style he's using because, of course, he did the entire arc, which means every 2 weeks he had to have 20 pages cranked out. I mean, I'm assuming he's doing it in advance. It's not like he's literally every week he's doing 10 pages. I wouldn't think. But so anyway, story-wise is fine. This arc, I could complain that Nightwing is falling into the stereotypical on most of the covers. He's getting his ass beat, and like the old Nightwing, which I just am not ever excited by, kind of a thing. So I'm curious to see what the next arc is going to be like and whatnot. And for me, that's going to be the real, do I want to stay on this or not stay on this kind of a thing. I am more of a Dick Grayson fan than what I used to be.
Yes,
me too. But still not, like, Nightwing's not at the top of my list of things to read as a general rule. Really loved Grayson. Grayson was a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah, I really enjoyed that.
You know, and this has got half of the crew from that on it. So, we'll see. It wasn't horrible, but it wasn't, like,
I was
super excited
going to suggest that maybe the, because I didn't realize, I wasn't thinking about different artists entirely.
Mm-hmm.
But I was going to suggest that maybe it felt lighter because Bloodhaven is a different place.
It's not Gotham.
Trying to take the darkness out of it because it's a different place. It's got, it's a coastal, gambling,
right,
fun town.
You're right. It's supposedly a clean version of Vegas.
And so maybe that's why he tried to make the art lighter and... But that doesn't explain why Dick's face looks a little. Not I don't that that his face looks doughy.
Yeah,
it just looks like a little boy.
Looks boyish.
But I was gonna say that might be the reason why.
Well, why they have him looking boyish like that now? Because they heard you complain about the fact that everybody had the 5 o'clock shadow
Fernandez
back in that.
This man hair that I was like, are you sure it's not Batman? Because why would they have the same chin, hair and chin? I remember. Thank you for bringing that up. That was just super sporting of you. But, that might be part of it. And also, you have to remember that what we're looking at there is a poster.
Well, it's a poster.
It's a poster somebody else made.
Right, right,
so
right.
So that's the other thing, is that it's okay if it looked a little funky because it's somebody else's
interpretation. I wasn't just meaning the cover.
I realize that. But
it looks like
that inside. That might be why he looks boyish to me. That's my idea. That maybe
still,
the palette is lighter.
Still, it's
that.
Still entertaining. It's just, I wish it was Grayson. I guess.
Well, there you go. Like
it really comes down to, and
like
I like the artist, and I like the artist before this. I like the artist before this too.
But
so,
do you think he's gonna stay in Bloodhaven, or do you think he's going back to Gotham?
He's got a girlfriend.
There's that, and I like what he's doing. I like the fact that he's working with.
Yes, I think he's gonna stay. Maybe he'll pop back and forth. I would think. But I'm guessing he's going to stay there in Bloodhaven just because, the old Nightwing, the first big Nightwing series, that's where he spent majority of his time. That was his place. He was actually a policeman there, was his day job.
Oh,
and then at night he was Nightwing. But that's, I think that's what they're going to do because there's way too many people in.
There's plenty of people in Gotham.
In Gotham.
Especially now that we've put Mother Panic in.
Not that Gotham doesn't need it, because clearly Gotham is insane, but...
It's the supervillain mecca.
Right, right. But I think
if you haven't made it as a supervillain in Gotham, you might as well stop trying.
Right. I haven't actually looked... I've been buying the comics, clearly, in advance, but I haven't looked at the solicitations to know where they're at, to know where he's at, but...
That doesn't surprise me, because you don't even like to know how many episodes are in a Netflix series. You just like to be surprised, and you hate reading the
synopsis. Well, because all it takes is that two or three sentences, and then you guess what's going on.
Probably
and it doesn't
people
have
don't realize that you have that 30 seconds into a murder mystery, a television murder mystery. You can just walk in the room and say who it is.
It's all those years of Murder She Wrote, seen every single season, every single show. It
But not on purpose. If you hear some squeaking, that's our cat Moon.
Anyway, Superman, issue number 16, the end of the multiplicity arc. I really enjoyed this. I love that. One of the things I love about the DC Universe is I love all the I love the multiverse, and the fact that they brought that all back after basically throwing it all out a few years ago, to me is lots of fun. I love seeing multiple versions of any of the characters, female versions, different male versions of things that shouldn't be or whatever. I enjoy all of that stuff. So to me, that's fun. This was a fun Superman comic, Superman story, but does not have this whole arc, does not have the same personal feeling that the stuff before it is. Because the stuff before it, it's father and son stuff, it's family stuff, so it has a much more kind of a personal level to it.
Yes, that's why I enjoyed the Trinity stuff more, because we still have John and
Lois
in it. Yeah. I heard about all the Earths. They pretty much converged right before I started reading comics.
Yeah, but you've seen them come back. You've read Grant Morrison's multiversity stuff,
yes,
and whatnot.
I did.
So you get to see the demon version of Superman in here.
And
Etrigan is Superman. That's awesome.
I think they're fun.
From Earth 13.
But yeah. And it was nice seeing, that nice sweet bunny turn back into
Captain Carrot. Go back to being Captain Carrot.
Yeah. It was a pretty cute bunny, though. It was fine. But I'm not as excited by... I'm not nostalgic about them because I didn't really experience them before that.
Sure. Well, they never get used like this back in the day.
I thought that was... I like the idea of the Supermen getting together and trying to figure out how to defeat their...
And they use the Yellow Submarine to do it?
What?
You didn't think that thing looked like the Yellow Submarine?
I now have to look at it. I guess it does.
So there's this device.
What's that?
Tell me that does not look like that guy's space age version of the Yellow Submarine.
I just wasn't thinking.
So it's this craft that they're flying around with that allows them to fly through the multiverse without ripping holes and things and causing all kinds of chaos and that sort of stuff. And it actually plays music like a music box, which is sweet in and of itself. See? We all live in a yellow submarine.
Okay.
A yellow submarine.
It's now 2 inches away from my face.
A yellow submarine.
You have a good point.
On the way.
Hopefully I will have a little bit more intelligent
in a yellow
things to say about submarine. Next time.
At any rate, they fight a big giant monster. I don't know. It's even got, if you're old school and like the old Crisis on Infinite Earth, the original event book. Back before event books got the ugly name that they have now.
Event books, back when event books were cool.
Yeah. they actually have a, they actually even have an homage to that, to the death of Supergirl, where Superman's holding Supergirl, except in this case it's Red Racer, which is a version of the Flash, held by President Superman.
Yes. And see, the Justice League, one of the animated series had President Superman, and so that's kind of fun thinking about that.
Yeah, so like I said, I really liked it, liked the art, I thought it was fun. It hints at the end of it to have to do, we've been seeing this guy, this hooded figure of the sickle,
yes,
that in Detective Comics has scooped up Red Robin, in Superman has gathered people up and whatnot, in Action Comics released Doomside and then
right,
scooped
and
up Doomside.
Took him back.
Right, so
Doomsday,
right, not Doomside, boy.
Well,
Dark Side,
Doomsday.
But
they all blend together.
So we get some hints at the very end of that, which is leading, I'm assuming, possibly into the whole button thing that's coming up for the whole DC Universe shenanigans, whatnot. But I really liked it, we also get a little bit of Superman, a new Superman action at the very end of it, of them sitting around in China, eating some noodles and kind of just talking about what's like being Superman, which is kind of cool.
Yeah,
too.
I enjoyed that part too.
Yeah.
I do like
him. Well, I think Tomasi and Gleason just do a good job of Superman's voice. The Superman that's the main person in this title. I think they do a good job of his voice. Even if he's not interacting with John or Batman or whatever,
I
like his voice quite a bit. So, surprisingly, continuing, Superman is one of my favorite DC books coming out of Rebirth, and I tell you... I have been attempting to read Superman since at least the early 80s, I have tried every version of Superman that's come out, every new Man of Steel, John Byrne, you know, anybody. I've tried all the versions except for Grant Morrison's Action Comics from Mini 52 and have not liked it. I haven't gone more than two or three issues at most. Love the book. It's a great book.
It is a really good book.
That's it. That's it for this week of superhero books.
Yay.
Maybe we'll be back next week. I don't know. We'll see. Have a good one, everybody.